Let's begin our worship service by standing. We're going to be singing, "Open Our Eyes, Lord."
Scripture reading today is going to come from 1 John chapter 2, verses the last part of verse 5 and verse 6. And he says, This is how we know we are in him. The one who says he remains in him should walk just as he being Jesus, just as he walked. And what I believe John is saying here in these verses is that true love for God is reflected through a life of obedience to his word and to what he says to us through the Holy Spirit. And so if we say that we know God and we love God, we should be living it out. And if we're not, just a few verses up from here, the Bible says that we're liars. So we don't want to be a liar today. And we don't want to serve God. We don't want to live for him out of an obligation just because he said so. We want to do it out of a heart of worship in response of who he is and for what he's done for our lives. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning that we are able to come and gather and together and worship you and lift up songs of praise to you, God. I pray that you would remind us to live a life of obedience is to live a life like Jesus did. Help us to love others and serve others just as he did, God. But also help us to grow closer to you as we seek to know you more every single day. Lord, give us strength to serve not only you, but to serve those around us. Lord, and just give us rest and give us peace as we go along, because we know, Lord, that sometimes being the only ones doing the same, doing that over and over again can be tiresome at times. And so I just pray that you just give us your peace as we go through that. Help us to be the light in this dark and broken world, Lord. And may all people we come in contact with know that we love God in the way that we live. We ask all of these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Silence, the roaring lion, declare the
please stand once more as we sing "It Is Well With My Soul."
Good morning again. Growing up, I always struggled to answer this question: what do you want to be, or what do you want to do when you grow up? And I don't know if it was because I just liked so many things I wanted to do, I just couldn't choose one of those, or if it was because I was kind of afraid to kind of stretch myself and just shoot for the stars like some people do. And so I wasn't not sure. Why I wasn't able to answer that question, but that was something that I struggled with, and I'm not sure if maybe you've experienced or maybe you are experiencing kind of the same thing, but let me tell you what I'm 100% confident in, that we exist to know and enjoy Jesus. So we get to have an intimate relationship with the God of the heavens, and that should excite us today. But if we're completely honest with ourselves, most of us aren't exactly characterized by an intimate relationship with God. And why is that? Well, the Bible says that we have an enemy, right? The devil. Satan is our enemy. And Satan, his goal isn't to convince you that God isn't real or that the Bible isn't true. As a matter of fact, he says that if you want to study the Bible, do that. If you want to go to church, you go for it. You want to seek God, do that. It's okay. Just make sure you look good while you're doing it. And make sure you go to the right college so you can get the right major, so you can get the right internship, so you can get the right job, so you can get the right boss, so that you can go to the right city and maybe buy the right house. Houses are expensive, so you're going to need roommates, so you got to get roommates. And then there's roommate drama, and in the middle of that, you meet somebody. And then you go on a date, and more dates. And then you gotta meet her friends and her family, and she gotta meet your friends and your family. And then, where's this going? Are we gonna get engaged? Are we gonna get married? We're gonna have kids? How many kids? Public school? Private school? What about our careers? Where are we gonna live? Then there's insurance and house insurance, car insurance, life insurance, and okay. So, got some more red light. And it's not that anywhere in the middle of all that we started to believe that God is not real, or that he's dead, or that the Bible isn't true. We just lost track of him somewhere along the way. And here's the thing. Reality is that for many of us, our problems aren't really the problem. It's our anxiety about our problems that become a problem. But remember what Jesus said in Matthew 6. He said, don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, what you're going to wear, because God knows that you need all of these things. But he says this instead: seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you. And so we see how he contrasts anxiety with seeking the word of, or seeking God's kingdom, the kingdom of God. So our anxiety actually can hinder us from fulfilling our God-given purpose. And so you see, the enemy's strategy to keep you from experiencing the fullness of God is to fill you with anxiety about the things of this world. That's his strategy. That's his goal. Jesus warned his disciples of this in Luke 8. And if you remember the parable of the sower. So he says that there's like the word of God is a seed, and it's planted in us, and it takes root in our hearts, and it's supposed to expand and grow, and to eventually where it bears fruit, that it goes out and blesses the world. And that's the goal. That's what we're supposed to be aiming for. But then he says the challenge is that there's, as this seed begins to sprout, there's going to be a weed that comes up and chokes the life out of it. And later he explains that this weed is the worries or the anxieties of life. And so the reason that many of you aren't experiencing the power of God in your life is because the word of life is being choked out by the worries of life. And so we've got to do something about it. And not only is this anxiety thing, not only does it affect our fulfilling God's purpose in our lives, it also leads us to a sinful state of mind. And here's what I mean by that. Anxiety about grades can lead you to cheat. You probably experienced this in grade school or something. Maybe college, it happens as well. Anxiety about dating can lead you to compromise what you believe is what lines up with Scripture about love and dating. Anxiety about finances can lead us to make unethical decisions. And anxiety for many of us leads us traveling down this road of addiction and to find relief from that. And that relief, that comfort that we get from that one problem can expand into a whole other issue in our lives. And here's the scary thing. Anxiety can actually kill you. We won't get into the statistics of all of that, but how many of you are affected physically or mentally by a preoccupation with a hypothetical situation? How many of us are worried about something that may not even happen? You know, I think for me I still struggle with that, and it's a real thing that we all probably are dealing with. Anxiety in our lives must be dealt with in some way. Ben Stewart, he's a pastor at Passion City Church in D.C. He said this: "The world is not impressed when we sing about the Prince of Peace, but live a life of stress." And it's easy for us to do. But when you really think about it, that's true. Like, the world is living and experiencing the same things that cause us stress, but it's how we handle it, it's how we deal with it, that the world watches us. As Christians, the world looks at us and says, Well, they're dealing with the same issues we've got going on, right? But how they deal with it, is it the same way that I deal with it? If so, then I'm not impressed by that. If it is, there's something that about them that I want. There's something different about them that I think I need. And I'm aware that there's some medical issues out there that are very real when it comes to anxiety, and I can't cover that today, but what I want us to do is to give us a pathway forward so that you and I can experience more of that peace that we get from God. And so, if you would turn with me today to Philippians chapter 4, titled today's message, The Great Exchange. And this is, we've got this anxiety, and so what do we do with it? Essentially, what Scripture teaches us is that we need to exchange that anxiety for the peace of God. And so that's going to be my point for today. But Philippians chapter 4, you've heard these verses many times, most likely. But we're going to pick up in verse 6. And Philippians 4, verse 6. And I'll read this verse first here. It says, don't worry about anything. In some translations, yours reads, be anxious for nothing. And I want to stop there for just a second, just to pause. Isn't it comforting to know that God didn't create us to be anxious? He didn't call us to do that. When he created you and me, he didn't say, and you must, if you want to follow me, be anxious for something. He didn't call us to that. And that doesn't mean you don't care, right? We obviously have cares in the world, but we weren't meant to carry the things that are weighing us down, to causing that gut-wrenching anxiety. But there is another way, he says. So listen to the rest of this verse. So don't worry about anything. Be anxious for nothing. But in everything, through prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Do you see that parallel in there? Be anxious for nothing. So I'm supposed to not worry about anything. But in everything, pray. Now, I know some of you are a little disappointed. You're thinking, man, I've just got my pen out. I'm fixing to write down the secret sauce to dealing with stress in my life, and you're just telling me I need to pray more? Like, I understand. I get it. But before you knock this theory, let me ask you to analyze your own. How are you dealing with stress, and how's that working for you? You know, for a lot of people, this verse would read, don't worry about anything, but in everything through social media. Some of you, when you get into an uncomfortable situation, you just kind of slip away from reality and get lost in social media, which often feeds your insecurity, and that leads to a whole other issue. How's that working for you? For some of us, many of us, we try to bury it under an addiction, and we know that that can lead in a million other directions that just create other problems. And so before you disregard this idea, I would like you to consider looking at your own and seeing how that's going for you. And here's what's interesting, that secular studies have been done all across our country. And so these are studies done by people with no religious affiliation or religious, they're not a part of the church. They're just secular studies. And they have stated that the best remedy for anxiety, and here's what it is, the best remedy for anxiety that secular studies have found is meditation and gratitude. And it's crazy because they're tripping into our text today and they don't even realize that what they're discovering has been God's truth for centuries in Jesus. And it's amazing that they're discovering these things, but that's the truth. Like, meditation and prayer, thanksgiving and, or meditation and gratitude, prayer and thanksgiving. So I will give you, this may not be the secret sauce, but this is just what I've found based on God's word in Philippians 4. How do we deal with anxiety? And so let me finish reading verses. Let me read verses 6 and 7 again for us. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses every thought, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so notice the first thing, if you're taking notes, the first blank is release your worries. That's the first thing we got to do. Release your worries. Release that anxiety. Notice the words in here. He says, with prayer and petition, if thanksgiving, let your requests be made known. He uses the passive form of the verb. He doesn't say, make your requests known to God. He says, let them be made known. Which is this idea that our requests, the cares and desire, the cares and anxiety, worries in our lives, they want to be made known to God. We just have to let them rise. We have to let them rise. You know, you walk in the church and somebody says, well, how are you doing today? And you're just like, I'm good. I'm doing great. Everything's fine. God is good. Hashtag not today, Satan, right? And so we do all these things. We push it down, but the Bible says we need to let it rise. Let them be made known to God. Let them be made known to Him. Does that mean that you need to let that out in every conversation? Not always, no. There's people may not can handle that sometimes, but we don't need to keep pushing them down. It's not healthy, and it's not helping. And so let them rise. How do we do that? Well, He says here, by prayer. By prayer. Prayer is creating this space to be with God. And in that time of prayer, listen, you don't have to try to make it cute. That's not what He wants from you. Just be real with God. And that's what He wants the most from us. He just wants you to be raw with Him. He can handle that. I tell our students that all the time. Just be honest with God. He can handle anything that you throw at Him. He can handle it because He's big enough. So you don't have to try to make it cute. Just, He wants His child to come to Him just as you are. And there's two verses I wanted to share with you in regards to this. 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your cares on Him because He cares about you. Cast all your cares on God because He cares for you. And then the other one is Psalm 55:22, which says, cast your cares on the Lord and He will sustain you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. And I love those two verses because in these two verses, we're given the same command, cast your care upon the Lord, right? But He gives us completely two different motivations as to why. So why do we cast our anxieties and our worries and our cares on the Lord? Because He's strong enough and big enough to do something about it. And he's loving enough and caring enough to want to. That's why we cast our cares on the Lord. And that's why we do it also with thanksgiving. You know, even though I'm walking through the fire, even though I'm feeling the pressure in the storms of my life, even though I'm sitting in a dark, lonely prison cell and I feel like I'm isolated and all alone and nobody's dealing with the same thing I'm dealing with, we get to come to Him in thanksgiving. I'm still thankful because I get to take my requests and my concerns to the King and I can find rest in Him. And that should give us a little bit of excitement. Even in the middle of the storms, we can be thankful because we have a God who cares. We have a God who wants to take that from us. And I remember when my wife, Mom, got to hold my nephew for the first time in Alabama about a year or so ago. I don't know, 2020 was, I don't remember if it was then or the year before, but we got to hold him for the first time. She got to hold him for the first time. And as she handed him back to my brother, she made the comment about him being heavy. And, you know, my brother's just like picking him up and says, oh, he's not too heavy for daddy. You know, it's, you know, presses him a little bit just to prove it, you know, to everybody in the house. The thing is, what feels heavy to you is not heavy to your Heavenly Father. What may feel heavy to you is not too much for Him to hold, not too much for Him to carry. The thing about God is He wants to carry your worries. He wants to carry your concerns. He wants to carry your anxieties, yes. But most of all, He wants to carry you. He wants to carry you. So we have to release our worries. Let them rise. Let them be made known. Let it go. The second thing is receive His truth. If we look at verse 8 today. It says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any moral excellence, and if there is any praise, dwell on these things. When you get up in the morning or whenever it is that you do your quiet time, don't just offload your cares to God and then walk on about the rest of your day as if you just hadn't experienced God. Like, that's only half the journey. So you need to pause so that you can embrace the truth of God's Word. Spend a little time extra with God. Give Him a chance to speak. Billy Graham once said, Prayer is simply a two-way conversation between you and God. And as I thought about that, like, that's not always how my life has been characterized. It's been a one-way conversation, me giving all my requests and me giving all my questions and me giving all my worries and me making, like, suggestions to God, which is not what I would suggest you do. But that's when, and then I do all that and I cut it off, say amen, and then I go walk on about my day. But God, like, as Billy Graham said, as the Bible teaches us too, give space for God to speak into your life. And he speaks through us in many different ways. I could probably go to our students and they give you a different answer. He speaks through it, through his word. He speaks through the Holy Spirit. He speaks through other people in our lives who God allows to, you know, to give us a message that way. And so God speaks to us. We just have to listen. We have to give him a chance to listen. And so being intentional about doing this, needing to, you know, pause in our conversation with God and allow him to speak. If we're intentional about doing this, it's going to enable you to function the way that God created you to do or created you to live. So you take those anxieties and those worries, you take them to God. And I'll tell you this too. You take those anxieties and your worries that were just about to affect the way that you treated or responded to your kids. Or take those anxieties and worries that were just about to affect the way you treated your spouse. But instead you take them to God. And then his peace will cascade over you. And as it does, you take in the truth of his word and it frees you to live out that peace. And you're no longer going to treat other people the same way. It's going to allow you to live a different way. To live in the way that God created you to live. Not as this anxious, worried, could pop off at any time kind of person. The peace of God rushes over you and his word, the truth of his word, frees you to live in that way. It's a gift from him, I pull you. So what truth, though, he says whatever is true, like dwell on these things, whatever is honorable, dwell on these things. What am I looking for in that? And I can't really tell you specifically what God may want to reveal to you today, but I do believe that there's someone here today that needs to know this truth. God is the author of your story. God is the author of your story. Your circumstances, your situations, all of these things, they do not define who you are. God does. Amen? God is the author of your story. I tell our students, I don't know that I've told it recently, but I try to tell them often, you know, if you ever start to question or doubt who you are in Christ, your identity in Christ, go back and read Ephesians chapter 1 in the first 13 verses. And as you read through there, as you see what God says about you in your life, highlight it, circle it, underline it, whatever you need to do to remember it, because it's important that you know who you are in Christ. It's important to remember your identity in him. God is the author of your story. And so he tells us who we are in his word if we are willing to read it. Jeremiah Burroughs, he was a preacher from the early 17th century. He says, and I'm just paraphrasing what he said, you don't pour wine into a shaky vessel. You have to steal the vessel. I'm still shaking because I'm nervous. But you steal the vessel and then you pour into it. And then you can, so you steal the vessel, then you can pour into it. And the same thing is true about the blessings of God. He has blessings for you. In his word, he has blessings that he wants to pour out over you, but you have to come before him and steel yourself so you can pour into your life. So you can pour into your life everything that he wants for you. He wants those. He wants that for you, but you just have to come to him still. So we want to release our anxieties. We want to receive his truth. But I want to add a third thing in here, and that is to rest in the God of peace. And so we'll finish off with verse 9 today. He says, do what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will go with you. Did you catch that? So if you read the first part of the verse, we have cast my cares upon the Lord, and the peace of God will be with you, right? And then receive his truth, let it shape the way you live, and the God of peace will go with you. And I love that. the peace of God. Not only do we get to receive the peace that God gives us when we come to Him as His children in need and just laying it all out there for Him, as ugly as it may be, we receive the peace of God. But then He promises also to go with us, and He's the God of peace. So we have His peace, and then we have God Himself. And in that, we are secure to move forward. We are secure to live a life that He's called us to live. And this can be your story. This can be your life. You can be the person who says, you know, I'm not going to let my anxieties get in the way of becoming who you say that I am, Father. That I'm going to be still, and I'm going to listen to your voice. And then I'm going to live knowing that you're going to be with me every step of the way. I remember when God called me to student ministry, and ultimately when He brought me to Shiloh, I was anxious. Yes, excited, anxious, and it was a good thing. I was excited, but also anxious as in, like, what have I just done? You know, I look around. Some of this stuff was nervousness and stress that I was dealing with. And I, especially as I looked around and I saw other youth ministers with hundreds of kids and student pastors who just had these awesome speaking skills. And they did these huge events all throughout the year and did all of this stuff. And that's what I was looking at. That's what I was seeing. And it always led me to a place of defeat in my mind and in my heart. And I, for lack of a better word, I was in this comparison trap. And I was stuck there. And then I just took it to God. I remember one day taking it to Him and just like, Lord, here's what I'm dealing with. I didn't try to hide it. I didn't try to make it eloquent or anything like that. I just took it to Him. And here's what I found in His Word, that I ultimately do not exist to be a student pastor. I ultimately exist to know God and to make Him known. And I do that by loving Him and loving other people. You do not exist to be fill in the blank. You exist to know Him and make Him known. That's what we're all about. And so I committed to loving on our students right where they were. And I committed to living a life that was honorable to Him. And even just living an example, trying to be a role model for them to be honest and to be real and to just share what God has, you know, placed on my heart to share His truths of the truth of His Word to our students and just kind of be there as that person for them, but also just in the whole circle that God put me in. And there's still a lot, obviously, that I don't know, but I'm not going to panic about the things that I don't have control of. And that's what I've decided. I just let Him grow me and stretch me. And sometimes, you know, even today, this is a stretch for me. My rubber band was stretched a little bit when Pastor Glenn said, do you want to take this Sunday? And I'm like, ooh, that's 3 weeks. Like, sure. And I'm knowing full well that I want to do this, knowing full well that I feel God, you know, honoring it and blessing it. But it still causes a little bit of anxiety. And so I'm not preaching anything to you that I've already, like, conquered and have control over. This is something I'm working on myself as well. And so you may be going through a storm today. You may have no idea what the next step is for you. But I invite you to come, and we're going to close with this. I'll invite you to come and lay down your worries and your fears and your doubts and your concerns. God invites you to come. Lay those at His feet today. Why should we lay our concerns at His feet? Because He's big enough to do something about it. He cares enough to want to. He loves you. He wants to carry you. He doesn't want you to have to worry about carrying your burdens. Let Him help you. Let Him take it from you. So live, release your anxieties to Him this morning. And then as you come to the altar, all across our altar today, I had some help this morning. Thank you, boys, for laying these cards out. And on every single card, I've picked I am statements from Ephesians chapter 1, the first 13 verses. I am loved. I'm forgiven. I am sealed. I am known. All of these things. So as you come and release your anxieties, I want you to take one of these cards. Take up His truth. Receive His truth. And then I want you to leave here today letting it shape how you live your life. Then you can come. I ask you to bow your heads in. Let's pray. Father God, thank you this morning that we can be known and be loved by you. Lord, and knowing that's who you are in our lives. And then knowing all the things that do cause us real stress and anxiety. I pray that you would just give us the strength to come and lay that at your feet, Lord, today, so that we can also take up your truth and let it change the way we live. Lord, help us to find rest in you. Lord, give us your peace that surpasses all understanding, as your word teaches. But not only that, Lord, help us to remember the promise that you will go with us. If we're willing to lay it down, that you're willing to go with us, Lord, through it all. And Lord Jesus, we ask if there's anyone here today that needs to know you, that doesn't know you as a personal Savior, I pray that they would also come, release whatever it is that's holding them back from a relationship with you, and not only taking back the truth of your word, God, but taking back a personal relationship with you. And that would be the best day ever for them. Lord, we pray that you have your way in this service. May the Holy Spirit move. May we be obedient to you. We ask all these things in your holy, precious name.